So Rick Twaniak kicked off the program this morning, and now what we're going to do is have a CTO panel kickoff. So I think it's very rare to get so many Cisco CTOs, or just CTOs in general, in one place, but they all felt it was important to be here and really, you know, help kick off DevNet, you know, answer any questions that you guys have. What we'll do this morning is that I'm going to start by asking questions, and we'll kind of go through the panels, and you know, the folks will be all interacting with each other. You know, after we get through them, we're going to open it up for all of you to ask questions. So go ahead and get ready to ask your own questions there. So just to introduce myself, my name is Susie Wee. I am the CTO of Networked Experiences. You've probably never heard network and experience in the same phrase before, but I try to pay attention to the networking technologies and what we can do to make very cool end user experiences. You guys see SpringRoll, augmented collaboration there. That's one of our projects. Improving kind of the network user interface. We have a project called Next, which is the network UI toolkit, which you can find out more about in the DevNet zone, in the developer experience. And here, what we're here is all about DevNet. It's about developers. For the first time, Cisco's kind of making really a full court press to get serious about making a great experience for developers, right? So that means getting the APIs and SDKs in place and so on. So now what I want to do is I want to have each of the panelists kind of introduce themselves and the technology area they're covering. Go ahead, Bret.
Morning, everybody. I'm Bret Hartman, and I'm the CTO for the security group at Cisco. So I'm responsible for defining overall technology strategy around security, where it's going at Cisco. And needless to say, the big focus is how does security get embedded across everything that Cisco does.
And Bret, can you tell us a little bit about yourself? What happened to you before you came to Cisco? Your career.
So I'm relatively new at Cisco. I've been on board about...
A little bit closer.
I can't get them on.
Yeah, there you go.
I've been on board about a year and a half as CTO at Security. Before that, I was CTO for RSA. So I did that for quite a while, so that's as part of EMC. I've been security technologist my whole career, 30-plus years. I was originally in the Air Force. I worked at the Super Secret National Security Agency, if anybody's ever heard of that. Did a bunch of startups, that sort of thing. So.
And someone told me before, working on security is like walking around with a kick me sign on your back, because everyone's always trying to hack whatever you do, but Bret's job is to keep us safe. John?
Hi, I'm John Apostolopoulos. I'm the CTO for the Enterprise Networking Group. We take care of enterprise switching, routing, and wireless. Additional things there include like indoor location-based services, which some of you may be playing with later on over here in DevNet. Also the Internet of Things, Internet of Everything. In regard to your second question, I've been at Cisco a little over a year. Before that, I was at HP Labs for about 15 years as a lab director, leading efforts in mobile, multimedia, mobile client cloud experiences, and so forth.
Great. And as a small point of fact, Bret and John are actually fraternity brothers back in college from their old days. Who knew?
And Lou? We met actually in Bret's office at Cisco. And that's actually where we first met.
You guys can guess which one is older. So, Lou?
Yeah. Hi, everyone. I'm Lew Tucker, CTO of Cloud Computing at Cisco. And one of the areas I'm most focused on these days is OpenStack, which is probably one of the largest open source communities now. So I'm very interested in developers. We've had probably over 1,200 developers now contributing to that platform. So it's a very exciting time to actually be a developer. And guess what? Infrastructure is cool again. That we're seeing people who are really talking about how they build cloud systems, and it extends even beyond the data center. So a lot of what we're doing is connecting up what OpenStack is able to do with some of the other layers in networking today. As in terms of background, I originally started in computing, more in high-performance computing, massively parallel supercomputers. I joined Sun Microsystems, part of the early Java team back when it was called Oak. So I've been involved with developers almost my entire career.
Excellent.
Lou, networking was always cool.
Networking has always been cool.
Sure. Especially as Dave was putting his code in the first routers. Tom.
Okay, I'm Tom Edsall. I'm CTO of the NCMA Business Unit. I'm responsible for the ACI, in particular ACI in the data center. I've been around Cisco for 21 years, something like that. Came in with the very first acquisition of Crescendo Communications, led a number of platforms over the years that you are all using.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dave Ward. I'm the CTO of Engineering and Chief Architect. I've been at Cisco since December 99. Spent a couple years at Juniper. Designed, at this point, about 21 high-end routers, several operating systems for those devices. Worked in MPLS, IP, routing, and have recently done a lot of work in SDN, NFV, and open source through the Open Daylight Project.
Excellent. And Dave is my boss. So
don't screw it up, Susie.
Tom, can you just tell us how many times you've worked at Cisco?
How many times I've worked? That's kind of a funny question, isn't it? I've been acquired three times by Cisco. Once with Crescendo, which was the first one, then Andiamo Systems, I started that company, and then most recently with NCMA, so that's the third.
So Tom's done a lot of the kind of disruptive breakthrough work that he's done both at Cisco as well as outside and brought it back in, so really helping to move our portfolio forward. Okay, so let me go through each of you guys and just tell me, like, so here we have a lot of developers. So people who've come here, they're interested in DevNet, they're interested in developers. What do developers mean to you and to your business and technology areas?
Sure. All right. So for security, there's been a huge shift in the whole industry around security. It used to be a lot of focus is about boxes, and of course there's lots of those, lots of firewalls, intrusion detection. We sell a lot of them, clearly. That's sort of where security has been for some time. But the shift is very much around security moving to a set of software services that are implemented and built on top of a fabric, and we'll be talking about that a lot. So it's an entire shift from self-contained security to something that developers build and build on the fly. And so we're seeing a lot of a shift to that across many, many areas of security, things like distributed denial of service and how do you actually build detection and prevention mechanisms for that, around different kinds of analytics approaches, and many other areas. So lots of opportunities for third-party developers to plug in on top of what Cisco's building to be able to extend security. I'll leave it at that for now. Lots to talk about there.
Thank you. John, what do developers mean for your business?
Sure. So let me talk about this in the context of Internet of Things and Internet of Everything. You've probably heard a lot about that, right? Well, if we want to make this building a smart, connected building, or make San Francisco a smart, connected city, or so forth for similar cities throughout the world, what we need to do is we need to gather together our collective intelligence, our collective creativity, to figure out what we can do to make this building more safer, more energy efficient, more useful for the people in the building, the same thing for the city around us. And to do that, what we need to do is build platforms which can enable our developers, enable all of you, for example, to be able to build on top and to apply your creativity really easily to create this next generation of the Internet of Things, Internet of Everything. So it's a really promising area where, as a community throughout the world, we need to work together to turn this into reality.
Great. Lou, you've been pushing developers a long time. I think you have this one.
Well, most recently, I think that what we're seeing is open source is becoming one of these areas where developers, it's not just the individual developers anymore, it's actually the community that's formed around these different projects that are bringing this forward. So it's we're divided into two pieces, one of which is these projects that make up the OpenStack platform, and then a foundation, and I happen to be vice chairman of that. But the developers rule, I mean, it's really about what they can produce, and it's a very big initiative within Cisco. We have a lot of Cisco developers there. But one of the things I advise people when they're getting involved with something like an open source project and is to go into it and start reviewing other people's code, because you need to make the connections in terms of reviewing other people's code. They will then review yours, and it goes around and around. I actually wanted to pick up on something John said about, you are in San Francisco. One of the great apps in San Francisco is something called SF Park. And that touches upon something called open data. What we're doing in San Francisco is that all of the parking spots that are available have sensors. And the city publishes that information for anybody to use. So there's a variety of different applications on your cell phone and everything else that are made by individual developers that can show you where the closest parking spot is to you. It benefits the city because it's less pollution, less crowding on the city streets and everything else, and it benefits the developers who bring out new applications based upon open data.
Great. Thank you.
So in the data center, I think for the first time we have a real opportunity for developers. With this new API controller and RESTful APIs, now a developer can focus on what they're trying to accomplish rather than focusing on the infrastructure and figuring out how to find all the switches and how they're all connected. That's all available through the RESTful APIs. And so now we can start to develop applications that will interact with the network, that will take advantage of what the application knows to drive behavior in the network. And I really think that ultimately there's a new frontier available to us where we start to break down this barrier between the infrastructure and the application. Huge long ways to go, but we certainly see a number of cases where some applications will run faster, will complete sooner, and can be more automated. And in the end, the way I like to think about it is that this focus on applications is really focusing on what's the most important thing in the data center. Because without those applications, we wouldn't build the data center to begin with.
So for me, Susie, the S of SDN is software, and software means applications. And we've heard over and over again over the last couple of years that the desires for automation of the network, the flexibility, the ability to make everything happen faster is going to be done through these applications. And that means that a development platform is necessary, APIs are necessary, and as a network engineering professional career changes towards using SDN, using controllers, as Tom mentioned, all of that becomes critical. So the new network engineer is also going to be a combination of a developer as well. And so catalyzing that developer community around networking is key for us in our portfolio architecture and key to transform CCIEs and the networking industry.
Great. Okay, thanks everybody. Now what I want to do is, you know, again, we have a lot of folks who are going to be, you know, coding, right? They'll be coding this week. We have a hackathon that's coming up. They'll actually be coding as they go back. You guys are all of our DevNet community members. Can you talk about the products or platforms in your areas that you want people to be coding to? And can you just describe a little bit about it so they know the types of APIs and the types of apps they can build?
All right. So back to security again for a minute. So on that side, we start with Snort. So Snort's an open source environment that's probably the largest community in the world around security for open source. It's massive, and that's about building different kinds of the rules engine and different kinds of rules on top of it for intrusion detection and prevention. So it's wildly popular, used all over the place and all over industry in terms of building your own custom security rules. In addition to that, a newer kind of extension to Snort is called Open App ID. And this is a way that you can build your own application-specific signatures. Think about what next-gen firewalls typically do for that long tail of applications that are there. New applications get built on a second-by-second basis. So the idea of having developers build their own application signatures to detect them turns out to be really important. Essentially crowdsourcing the whole notion of how do you build and recognize all these new applications. Based on that, you can define rules to decide, say, which users in an organization are permitted and to access those applications and under what circumstances. So those are a couple examples. There are several others, but just as a starting point, definitely Snort and Open App ID are definitely things to check out.
Hey, Bret, why don't you also mention identity also bringing in ICE as well?
So that's as a case in point. On the ICE is the Identity Services Engine product. And so ICE is all about, especially in the bring your own device space, this is our product that's used to be able to authorize what kinds of, say, mobile devices or tablets or whatever can access a wireless or wired endpoint. And so ICE is another, Dave's point, an important developer interface, so you can build and extend ICE to define new policies.
So think about that a bit. When talking about defining new policy, that means when somebody logs onto the network, and uses .1x, for example, on a Wi-Fi network, you can understand who that person is or what that device is and automatically program a segment of the network and isolate them from other parts of the network instantaneously. And then, as Tom will describe, through the APEC declarative language, tie that directly into workload policy. So no longer can that HVAC contractor who has malware on their laptop plugging into the air conditioner suddenly get access to a point of sale inside, say, a Target store, as an example,
just
and we suddenly lose 73 million credit cards and CEOs are losing their jobs. Never will happen.
And, yep, and here you guys, we can actually take time to go through the various technologies because this is what gives people a lot of information here. So thanks for jumping in on that. Go ahead. So John, what platforms and technologies? We actually have a lot of coverage of your technologies out in the DevNet zone.
Yeah, so I'll probably answer this question by talking about four of the technologies we have in the DevNet zone, which you can go and play with starting today. And with the hackathon starting tomorrow. So the first one is something called connected mobile experience. And let me give you an example of what happens here. Many of you probably flew in here, and once you landed, you turned on your mobile device, and then first of all, you're seamlessly connected. You got your email and so forth. Second of all, via GPS, you found out your location. And third, via location-based services, you may have used Yelp or other things to find out nearby restaurants, you find maps to figure out how to get to Moscone and so forth. These are some things that are really easy for you to do with cellular or GPS. Now, once you come inside a building, though, and most of us spend most of our time inside buildings, those sort of location-based services don't work because GPS doesn't work indoors, right? So what we're trying to do is we've developed something called Connected Mobile Experience that allows us to use the wireless infrastructure, the Wi-Fi infrastructure, to help you determine your indoor location, and then based on that to be able to provide indoor location-based services. So that's something which is up and running over here in the DevNet zone, and you can go and play with it and try to build your own services.
Hey, John, so on that, when you say indoor-based services, what do you mean? Are you talking retail? Are you talking about drive-bys and coffee shops? What exactly do you mean?
Kind of all of the above, and it's up to our creativity to see what we can do. For example, at retail, retailers love the ability to know how many people are entering the store, where are they going, how many people are in line. At a hotel, the hotel manager wants to know how many people are in line in front of the lobby waiting to register. So then they can automatically send more people there, automatically. Okay? These are some of the things that can be done. Also, what happens is we're working with various retailers such that if you want wireless access, you can, for example, use your Facebook credentials, if you wish, to opt in and to automatically get connected and to get indoor location-based services from the retailer. So this is part of the ecosystem, the software ecosystem is being developed to make it easier and easier for you to get indoor location-based services.
John, why don't you give one more example of how it's used in Vegas?
Ah, so Vegas is a fun thing. So how many people here are familiar with the Bellagio?
Vegas, baby.
So Bellagio, as many of you know, is a very well-known large casino. Okay, a few things about Bellagio. First of all, it's very big. Second of all, it's easy to get lost. You know, that's kind of by design, because they want to keep you in there. Third thing, the Bellagio wants to provide to all the people enter the Bellagio the best experience possible. Okay, so what does that mean? They want to provide you indoor location-based services, so you know where you are, you know where you can go to gamble, you know what restaurants are available, you can see the menu, you can easily make reservations via single touch. They even want you, believe it or not, to be able to find the closest ATM machine. So these are all things that can be done very easily. And this is something which we did a proof of concept with the Bellagio, where they were deploying this and using it with their customers. So yeah, this is very popular in casinos, in hospitality, hotels. Also, we get a lot of interest in airports, train stations, and so forth, as well as universities.
Hospitals, too. It works out extremely well inside a medical facility to understand what room you're in, and then associating it with a patient in the room, automatically getting access to their medical records data, the machine that goes bing, understanding what that means and what's going on with that particular patient, all done via location-based networking.
Yes, it's a very powerful concept, as you can see. And the key thing to make use of this is our creativity, right? What sort of cool, useful apps can we build for people? Okay, and that's where all of you come into play. We're building the CMX platform with the APIs, RESTful APIs. You can go learn about it and play with it here. And please try to build some creative apps. And there's a hackathon over the next couple of days, which I'm personally very excited to see the type of creative apps you build.
And so one interesting thing to note in terms of Cisco is that you can actually write apps. You know, you might think of Cisco as we can write apps for managing the infrastructure, managing the wireless network and things like that, you know, the data centers and so on. But in addition, there's a set of end-user apps that we can build, right? So, you know, all of these end-user apps for retail, for parking, for other areas. So we're enabling developers of all sorts here. Great. So, John, I think you have many more technologies. So,
should I talk about them now, or should I pass them on to my colleague?
And then we'll come back to talk about the other ones.
Okay. I only need to talk about one, which is think about building these applications not in the old-style way, where you might have to stand up your own Oracle database and you're provisioning a physical machine and then accessing these APIs. Instead, in OpenStack, if you're deploying that on-premise in your own cloud, you can write it as a cloud-native application, being elastically scalable at the same time that you're accessing these APIs to manage your own infrastructure. So a lot of misconceptions about cloud is that it's only designed for web-based applications. What we're seeing more and more is it's actually now being designed for system infrastructure applications because of the availability of the RESTful APIs that we see here. The other thing that we're doing at Cisco is that we're tying in the OpenStack APIs and everything else into the infrastructure itself through ACI, through Open Daylight, and other areas. So at a higher level, developers can start developing applications and take advantage of those new capabilities. Last comment, just on in terms of this, there's an awful lot of new information, and I would urge you to really try and learn as much as you can. You don't necessarily have to be jumping in to write the code, but please learn what you can here, because ultimately I think that all CCIEs and everything else will be moving into this DevOps model, and that's where automation and using some of these APIs are there to make your life much, much easier.
So just to carry on a little bit from what Lew was just saying, that I think this integration with orchestration tools such as OpenStack and Open Daylight are going to be a fundamental part of what you do in your daily lives and how data centers are run. The day of the command line hero, I think, is numbered. And we're going to be using more and more automation. And so using the RESTful APIs that we're providing on these products is how we'll be interacting with them. We do provide a command line, but we write it in Python on top of our API. We do have a GUI, but we write it on top of our API. So those APIs are really where the power comes from. And we don't have all of the sexy location services that John has. However, we do, although we don't call it that, we have location services of where your applications are located, and you can understand where they are in that data center, how do they interact, how close are they together in a networking sense, and how their placement might be optimized. And there's research that shows that we can improve application performance by as much as 20% by taking into consideration the network topology when you do that placement. So working through with tools like OpenStack and connecting that through the APIs of the 8-bit controller, you can start to return real value to your clients and to your company. And so I think there's a real revolution in front of us on what can be done now with these APIs.
But it's really, if any of you are working in big data, knowing where your VMs are inside of a cloud platform order is critical to getting that kind of performance. That's a lot of the tests that we've done, and we're able to use a low-level API then to actually direct where you place this. Usually you want either virtual machines to be very close together, perhaps on the same host, which is they have affinity, or you want anti-affinity, which is that you want them as far apart as possible to increase your resiliency. Those are the kind of things, the higher level abstractions that are enabled by having these lower level primitives giving that information back to platforms like OpenStack.
But then it can also change how you run your operations. If a link fails, if there isn't a critical an application using that link, well, maybe you'll fix it next week. But if it has a critical application, maybe you're going to fix it right now. And so how you react
programmatically as well.
Yeah.
That's what you really need to be able to. You need to be able to react at the speed of software, no longer waiting for that tech to come out and fix it.
Yeah, if the application allows you it to be moved, or if it can take a reaction, have a reaction to it internally, that's obviously the best, but sometimes that's not always possible. So knowing the impact of events that are happening in the network can influence your overall behavior and become ultimately much more efficient.
And so what's interesting about this is that we've changed our embedded operating systems and protocols to now be pushing data in real time out of the network, to give the controllers and give the application platforms the ability to see all this in real time. So it's been a 2-year journey of modifying, the IGPs, modifying BGP, and using this to be able to push data out. But we've also now changed some of the standardized protocols so that way it stays open, but allows us to program IP, MPLS, all its service activation on the edge, and really have gone across the portfolio to provide these APIs for programmatic interfaces. But I've got to be honest, I don't expect a lot of people to write necessarily applications directly onto the embedded device. Instead, you've heard Tom and others talk about controllers and abstraction outside the embedded OS, and that's really the place where we see the highest number of developers going, as well as partners building on top of these platforms. So something I talked about yesterday, dovetailing off what both Lou and Tom were saying, when you integrate the resources available in the cloud and in the data center, what CPU you have, where the workloads are placed, how much memory, et cetera, storage, and you link that together with attributes in the WAN of delay, jitter, load, reserve bandwidth, et cetera, you can answer a simple question of where should I place my workload where it will meet the SLA for the user. You couldn't have been able to answer that question before without a whole lot of hard work and lots of pulling of the network. But now that we're pushing data out, putting it into the controllers, and giving access to it, we can now answer that question very, very simply.
Yep.
Actually, Dave, could you comment on how this applies also to some other big term people talk about, NFV?
So NFV, being network function virtualization, is really taking a lot of Bret's stuff down at the end there, who said it was all hardware-based in the past, and now almost, if not all, of Bret's portfolio is running as a virtual appliance. Well, running something as a virtual appliance doesn't make it any easier to manage or any easier to orchestrate or control than a hardware appliance. And in particular, when you want to tie it in with, say, a VPN customer or a residential service or to a group of users via their identity. So what we've done in working with Lou and with all the guys up here is build out an orchestration platform that allows us to orchestrate the infrastructure, build the virtual overlays, program the IP addresses, et cetera, such that you can have a service chain on a per-user basis. And additionally, what we've enabled is made this fully user-driven. And so now we're working towards having user-driven portals that allow folks to select the services that they need from the network, and it automatically gets orchestrated via OpenStack into the cloud itself. And this entire loop of tying things together and allowing a user to define exactly what they want from the network and have it done in minutes or seconds is a dramatically different way of running a network than the past.
Yeah, actually, I just want to observe that whereas in the past, we would have had different sort of silos here. What Dave's talking about, we're all now having to work together because these are all interrelated to each other. And fortunately, we have RESTful APIs, we have orchestration systems, we have changes in the network itself that allow us to programmatically start to think of this as an entire system. So it forces us to work together because we've got use cases here, and we've got technology capabilities as well.
It's not really forcing us. It's like, I want to work with you.
But some people are
open source efforts are going to enable our products. I want that NFV because it makes everything much more valuable. So
I think you guys want it too.
Yes. Yeah, some people are surprised. But yes, the CTOs at Cisco work together.
When I see Dave, this is like the first time I've seen Dave in probably 2 years in this country. I've seen a lot of other countries oddly.
Yes. John, you have more platforms that people can use. So go ahead, keep on going.
Sure. So we have a few other platforms you can talk about here. Let me mention the controller, for example. So Tom and his team helped develop the ACI controller, and Dave and his team are driving the Open Daylight controller. And what happens is my team, the enterprise, is working on the APIC enterprise module, which is a controller to help within the enterprise. And these are all being designed to have the same sort of APIs going northbound to the developers. So from your perspective, you can hopefully be able to interact in the enterprise, the data center, and so forth, using the same APIs and the same understanding and so forth.
Hey, now, John, on that note, so you're going to see down in the world of solutions when it opens up later today, our entire partner program is now oriented towards having our partners code to these platforms as well. And so it's really interesting to see how far and how fast SDN has gone in Silicon Valley, number of startups and the number of partners that we have building directly to these APIs. And that's really where folks' careers can go in building whole new applications and orchestration systems systems to better the network experience.
Yeah, maybe to point that, and again, back to security for a second, a lot of the startups I talk to in the startup space are exactly doing that, right? In security, they're using those ACI interfaces, in fact, exactly to build new kinds of security functionality on top of it. A lot of examples.
Yeah, with these APIs, it becomes much easier to deploy L437 services for providing security, to gather information, do big data analytics on that information to tell you more about what's going on, and not only about security, but also about the health of applications and the performance of those applications. And so, you know, huge opportunities. This is something that's relatively new, and so, you know, the future's in front of us.
So this, as was mentioned, is a great opportunity, and this is also a great example of a lot of the collaboration that's going underway across the groups, so that it makes it much easier for developers to develop on top and to leverage these capabilities. As an example, on the enterprise side, so why do you want a controller? Part of the reason you want a controller is, many of you who work in the enterprise today, you would know that it's hard to have visibility in terms of what's happening within the enterprise network. It's hard even to sometimes get topology information and so forth to figure out what's congested, what breaks down. You can solve those problems, but it's hard. With a controller, what can happen is you can very quickly get visibility across the entire infrastructure. And once you have visibility, you can go in and do management and automation much, much better than before. And that's incredibly powerful.
So, for example, built into the controller that John mentioning is actually a library of our Cisco validated designs, where if you need to deploy voice over IP, not only does it learn the devices, learns the version of iOS running on it, and can deploy the Cisco validated design, you know, parameters instantaneously, whether it's voice over IP or CoLab or telepresence or any of these other pieces, making hopefully your life a whole lot easier than pushing out all those config files.
Yeah.
Actually, one of the common themes I'm also seeing in terms of a design pattern is that if you're thinking now about building an application to one of these controllers or something, don't think about it as just an application. It can also be a service for another application. And if you approach it that way, instead of just putting your system administration management console directly on top of that, write the APIs as if it were a service first. And then you can put a GUI on top of that, or even a CLI. But you open it up to them being reused by many other applications. So think of these applications / services as themselves being services that have APIs that continue to extend your functionality into many other areas.
Luke, use the API.
That's the mantra these days. It's really about the APIs, and every app should have an API so it can be used by other applications.
So one thing I wanted to mention, John, about your controller is that we realize that a whole lot of networking kit out there today don't have these APIs. So a couple of things. One, it is an upgrade part of your current service contract, and so as you roll these out, you know, there's effectively only a software upgrade required, but also built into the controller are Southbound plugins that actually interact with the CLI as it is today. So you can drop in these and start using these controllers and these controller-based systems with existing kit without an upgrade, and then as you decide to transition your network into network architecture, it automatically uses those APIs.
Yep, absolutely. And actually, can I jump in on next now while we're at it? So we're talking about where we have, you know, APIC EM or ACI, and we're saying we want to use the different applications and think of them as network services you put on top. We want to use the APIs. In addition, another platform that we have is something we call Next. So, and Next is a network UI toolkit. So you'll see some cool network topology UIs in different places. You know, you'll see it on top of APIC EM. You see like kind of the topology or expanding, collapsing nodes showing traffic on top. It's actually going to be used on the NOC. So if you go down to our live NOC, you'll see a picture of a topology up on top that uses the Next UI toolkit. So it's an HTML5 JavaScript-based toolkit that you can use to actually then, you know, easily kind of create and visualize topologies. We're going to have people, we actually have some learning labs on it, and we actually have, can use it in the hackathon. But right now it's not available externally. It's our first time opening it up, so you guys can give us feedback on whether or not you would like to use it after the show.
So a good way to get access to this code, we built the virtual internet routing lab as well, which has completely virtualized instances of the OSs that run on the gear itself. So it's virtual iOS, virtual NXOS, virtual XR, et cetera, that can actually import your exact network topology, give you access to APIC EM, give you access to Open Daylight, as well as other applications on top, which can run on your laptop and can run in the cloud depending on how big your topology is. So being able to import your network, being able to import all your tools, being able to import these controllers and begin working on it, you can see the impact without actually touching your network to get off the ground and to begin coding.
Absolutely. One little commercial. So if you're on Twitter, follow at DevNet Zone, at Cisco DevNet, and then you can tweet to the hashtag DevNet Zone and feel free to tweet away. I've been tweeting from up here a little bit.
And there's a mic up here if anybody wants to ask any questions from the audience.
Okay, John, do you have one more platform for us to talk about?
No, sure. Yet.
Wow, that's not prompting. He's a John.
So I'll talk about Internet of Everything now.
There we go.
So for Internet of Everything, the question is, how can developers build on top, right? Because how can you build apps on top of the Internet of Everything? It's very complicated. All kinds of proprietary protocols. Do you have to know all this networking protocol? Do you have to know all how to do the right security and so forth? Well, to solve this problem, we've developed something we call IOX. It's a platform which is designed to leverage Cisco's multi-decade expertise in internet networking. That is to leverage iOS, as well as to leverage one of the greatest open source platforms that exists, Linux. So what we've done is we put these two together. So therefore, you can develop on top of Linux and then access all of the Cisco internet networking protocols and capabilities to build your applications. We believe this can be hugely valuable for application enablement, the Internet of Everything. And you can go play with it over here, where you can actually build your own apps to run on Cisco routers that have IOX running.
And if you actually look in the hackathon area, we actually have these CGR routers that are like on the tables themselves, and these are the same things that you find on top of telephone poles, right? The kinds of things that you can actually do to make some interesting internet, IoT and Internet of Everything apps. And so you can get hands-on with them here.
Hey, so what's interesting about that, John, is that means that if you've got an idea for the next thing, whether it's a wearable or it's a sensor inside a, you know, within an industry or manufacturing or consumer device, it means that with your Kickstarter project, you're now coding in Linux. You're now getting all of the information out of the network itself, and you can tie these two together without having to build out all new protocols, which become really, really can be challenging. So, Susie, there was a question I want to ask to Tom, actually.
Sure.
So, on your APIC controller, you know, as we now actually can talk about potentially legacy SDN, which is interacting and downloading, you know, box by box, potentially in a parallel nature, the configuration that's necessary, you've invented a declarative language. What do you mean by declarative language in defining network policy through a language-based construct?
So, what we mean by a declarative language is a language that you express your intent, and then there's an assumption that the underlying component will carry through on that intent. And the example that I like to use, and I've seen used a couple times, is if we had a declarative language at the airport, when the air traffic controller talks to the pilot, they say, you know, come in on bearing 270 and come in to land. And I'm not a pilot, so you know, you can fill in the details. The contrast to that is an imperative language, where you go in and say exactly what must be done. And in that case, that air traffic controller would have to be an expert in how to fly a Boeing 707 and a Cessna 172. And depending on the plane that was coming in, he would say, well, now you need to push on the right pedal a little bit, or push on the left pedal, or push the joystick forward. It would be the detail. And that air traffic controller then would have to be an expert in each one of these airplanes, and clearly that system would not scale. And so we want to have that kind of abstraction in the network itself. So we don't get in from the controller. The controller doesn't know what bits are being programmed into the forwarding engines or the ASICs. They don't know the details of how to turn on a port or how to enable a VLAN or how to enable routing someplace. It runs at an abstraction level that says, enable the port, turn on the routing, and then let the underlying component take care of that. And it's all part of what we call promise theory, and it's a declarative language instead of an imperative language. So this abstraction in the end is extremely important, and getting the abstraction right is fundamental. And I think we've seen that we have done a very good job of getting that right, and based upon the rapidity that we've been able to integrate with programs such as OpenStack and CloudStack and some of these other tools that are using these APIs. And one other thing I'd like to add, you know, some of you have probably been around networking for a long time and are really, really great at using the command line. And I said that, you know, the command line hero is going to be a dying breed. Don't be intimidated by all of this talk about APIs. It's actually easier to use. It becomes, you know, that sort of that first step is difficult to get past, but then it's surprisingly how easy it is to use this stuff. And
it's great to hear all these network guys talk about APIs.
I'm not a hardcore networking guy. I was able to have things running on my Mac, in my office, you know, working with our controller. And I was like, wow.
Building on top of that, right there we have Mandy Whaley in the audience. Wave your hand, Mandy. She's actually giving our DevNet Coding 101 Intro to Coding class. No experience necessary. Bring your laptop. She'll help you get your environment set up, you know, run Postman, teach you about the different tools that you can use to actually call some REST APIs. So Mandy will be running that. You can look for it on the schedule. And if we want more classes on it, we're happy to schedule those. Just let us know at the desk.
I wanted to add to what Tom was saying also, because the advantage now, if I'm assuming most people here are in the networking space, but your application developers are developing like web apps and everything else like that have always been a real problem, because they're coming to you and saying, okay, I want to put this app up on the web or whatever, and you have to now explain to them, well, what are the policy, what are the security rules, you need this, what are the firewalls, we have to do this. By having this explicit statement of policy, now they can actually project that so that developers themselves simply say, yeah, I want to have a web front end and I'm going to have a back end database, and I don't want the back end database to be routable from the internet. That's expressed as a policy that can be set by the corporation or by the owners of the data center itself, without having to force the application developers from understanding all of the rules and minutia associated with how those policies are executed. That can be left through the policy-driven APIs into by the rest of the infrastructure team and set by that team.
I don't want my credit card readers to talk to my air conditioning units.
So also, back to Bret, when you tie this whole notion of policy and workload to policy, what Bret's bringing, as he mentioned earlier with ICE, is that you can take now identity along with the networking policy that you want, so that way Dave only has access to certain types of workloads depending upon the device that he comes in. Again, a very simple question to ask, but very, very hard and challenging to do in configuration.
Yeah, I mean, there's several security examples here. To Dave's point, one is that oftentimes you get this kind of intelligence in terms of potential suspicious behavior within a network, but tying it back in terms of context back to the user, back to the device, actually makes it usable for an administrator. Another example, just back to the programmability as we think about things like ACI, is that typically when you have breaches today, when malware gets inside an organization, it spreads very, very rapidly. I've actually personally been involved in watching some of those breaches and watching the malware spread. You think, no problem, just shut it off, right? You can't, because you can't shut down the organization. You can't start pulling cables. So what happens in a lot of these cases is this malware spreads to potentially, you know, huge numbers of machines, which is really expensive to clean up, does a great deal of damage. What we can do through these programmable interfaces is we can dynamically change policies and isolate the spread of that kind of malware. That's something that's almost impossible to do, back just a couple of years ago. We can, for example, you might have malware that infiltrates, let's say, the finance department, but we can isolate it and prevent it from going to other parts of the organization. That's actually a big win. So that's yet another example.
But even some basic stuff, Bret, when somebody puts a malware in that goes off to a different DNS server, and making it incredibly easy to whitelist or blacklist DNS servers and DNS redirects, all of this bread and butter stuff that can be really challenging to chase around the barnyard if you're trying to run those by hand.
That's right, and today is done very much by hand on a network device by network basis, which just does not scale exactly to the point. So that's exactly the idea of using controller. If you could do it at that level, you have a shot of being able to do it.
If your enemies are using software to attack you, you need software to counter that attack.
Yeah. Great.
And then they attack the software, and then you counter. Anyways, look, turn it all the way down.
Okay, so folks in the audience, get ready to ask your questions, and feel free to come up and join us at the mic. I'm just going to take one that some of you guys can jump on. Do you guys have examples of apps that others have written you know, on some of your platforms, and we can kind of filter in the answers and, you know, get questions from the audience as we go. Does anyone have any good examples?
Well, there's a very simple one for OpenStack, and that is Comcast has taken upon themselves. All of Xfinity is going to be deployed on OpenStack in many, many data centers. So if you're watching TV and you're wondering why your cloud DVR is paused too long, you can send a note to me or whatever, and we'll try to get it fixed.
So towards that end, Lou, working with you, many of you probably have read about Comcast Cloud DVR expansion up and down the East Coast of the U.S. They went from zero to over 100,000 users in about 5 months because they did this all based in the cloud and were using OpenStack.
Okay, question.
Yes, I have a question regarding the virtual router simulation environment. What I'd like to do is I'd like to use that to create a virtual replicate for my enterprise network. So when I need to make a change, I go to the virtual environment to make the change for the test out before I actually execute it. And the question is, you know, I have iOS, Nexus OS, ASRs, and all those variety of hardware platform, variety of versions of the code running out there. How ready the environment is for me to simulate their environment. Also, how well does it scale? Let's say I have a 100 sites, 100 devices out there. Can you comment on that?
Sure. So right now, Viral does scale to the multiple thousands of devices. I've seen it run over 10,000 devices at one time. It has virtual copies of virtual instances of all these different routing images, as you mentioned. And so you can see it right back there in the in one of the labs. You can see it over in the world of solutions. And you can also run your entire network for pre-flight checking via Oculus Rift as well. So it's ready. And for the pre-flight checking as well as design modeling, because it's running in the software, and it's running virtual instances, you can pause. It's got revision control in it for where you are with your config changes, and now you can go to your IT manager and say, here's my five-phase architectural plan and five-phase config changes, and pre-flight check everything before it touches hardware.
So what it takes for me to get started?
You walk right back there. It's the first booth on the right, and those guys are ready to talk to you about it.
Yes. Hey guys, my name is Bhavan. I'm from Canada.
And welcome.
Thanks. Great direction. Really appreciate what you guys are doing. It's amazing. And thanks for the support and organizing this. I'm an early adopter of technologies. We do cloud applications in Canada, working with Cisco. And I had the opportunity to use MSC and be one of the first to build early applications, web applications using MSC. And one of the challenges we run into was deep insights into a black box. So how do you get us some insights? Because using API is something we do day in, day out. It's very straightforward, APIs are great. But business knowledge of how notification works, why do we see delays 8 seconds, 10 seconds, when it's supposed to be real time? How do we bridge that? How do you plan on opening that insight for developers like us who are basically bleeding edge developers?
So a couple different ways. As I mentioned, we've extended and expanded the pushing of data out of the network. So today, for example, with 1PK, you have to actually go and pull each and every device. So we've modified the protocols to be able to push the data out. As I mentioned, all the IGP data, all of the BGP data, all of traffic engineering, just as one example. But also what Tom has worked on within CME now is pushing each and every statistic and making that available. And the relationship between links, whether it's in the spine of the data center or associated with the top of rack switch, and making all of these statistics available in real time. But we have to realize, and you probably know this just from the old days using SNMP, traps and informs and events can absolutely overwhelm a controller. And so one, we're using, of course, thresholding that you set when do you want to receive an event, but also we're changing, we've learned through just the rapid iterations of controller eras that we have inside the company and in open source with Open Daylight, for example, we know that we need to take these events and put them on a service bus, which allows us to publish all the events in an application to subscribe just to the events they want. So in carrier Ethernet, for example, in a huge service provider network, there will be tens of thousands of devices, and you need to know, if you want to track a particular user or subscriber, you only want to subscribe to that particular event. So it's critical to enable a pub sub type architecture inside these controllers, which is what Tom has done and is what's going into OpenStack, as well as what we're putting in Open Daylight as well. So right now, that's headed and being built this summer. It's further ahead in certain communities than others, but that's the way that I highly recommend that you begin coding in a pub sub type model.
So a little bit more about specific platforms in the APIC data center model where we have our controller. The southbound API of that controller is published as OpFlex. We released in the IETF draft just a month or so ago. And we will have open source implementations of that on the OBS switch as well as an Open Daylight. So we have visibility what's going on there. However, what we communicate across that API is to a logical model of the switch. This is part of being declarative instead of imperative. On the switch itself, we render from the logical model to what we call a concrete model, what is actually happening on that implementation of that piece of hardware. All of those objects are also available through that API. So you can look at exactly how is the TCAM programmed or how is this thing set up, et cetera. So absolutely everything is visible. To give you an example of this, we had a bug in one of our ASICs.
What?
luckily, there's no bugs. It was around a counter, and it turns out that this counter, if you look at this counter, it's not going to make any sense to you at all. It doesn't count the right thing. And I was asking the team, is this something we're going to expose to the end user or not? And they said, well, just by the way the software is defined and the way our toolkit works, we cannot hide it. And so, yes, we will get a call about that counter because when you look at it, it's going to have a value that doesn't make any sense. But just to give you a sense that absolutely everything is available.
Hey, so let's change the conversation for a second about Internet of Things and Internet of Everything, which is that we realize that, again, now you're talking about millions, tens of millions, hundreds of millions of devices out there. And John, this is kind of for you to tee up. We realize that an information hierarchy is necessary. As the data is all produced, it has to be consumed and aggregated at different layers all the way out to the edge and then centralized all the way back, which gives you the ability to dive all the way down, but will give you a higher level abstraction. And we find that information hierarchy in information model is absolutely critical to be able to scale out large networks. At Cisco, we don't believe in the grand unification of controllers, meaning that we're not trying to build one controller that solves everything. That's also an untenable and unscalable software task. And so this is why we've taken four different networking domains, from data center to enterprise to branch to Internet of Things to service provider, using all the same software architecture for orchestration and building out these controllers, but built specific platforms for specific tasks, which is why you see DevNet segmented into 6 or 8 different groups out there.
Yep. So that's why you have APIC EM, APIC DC, and it's because those are focused on those particular areas.
Now, focus platforms.
And then we also have some libraries called Data in Motion as another set of APIs, so that might be worth talking about.
Yeah, so one of the things that Dave mentioned was scale. And in the Internet of Everything, you have a humongous number of sensors and different devices need to be controlled in the future. We're all familiar with analytics, right? And we all realize analytics are key to many of the things we're doing today, as well as in the future. Now, when we do analytics, like with all the mobile devices, which many of you have right now, that analytics is typically done in the cloud, right? How often do you notice that the connection to the cloud is not working very well? Either because you have limited bandwidth, or the latency is too high, or you don't have connectivity because you may be on a plane or something. In all those cases, you actually would like to do the analytics locally instead of doing it in the cloud. Okay? And this is something we've been working on, something we call fog, where the idea there is you take the processes done in the cloud, and you also can move some of it and distribute it closer to the edge of the network. Okay, that's why we call it fog, because you've done it close to the ground, close to the edge of the network.
It's just a low-lying cloud.
Exactly. It is. It basically is.
Point this here for me. Sorry, I couldn't miss it.
You're in San Francisco, you'll see it daily.
And iOX, of course, will be running there, which I described before. That's a combination of iOS and Linux. And to perform the analytics there, we have something we call data in motion. And what data in motion is, it's a very small footprint piece of software that can take the data coming in real time, streaming data, and while the data is in motion, as it's coming in, we can process it, detect things, and take actions locally. Okay? You can still forward it to the cloud and do all the big data analytics, but this also gives you the ability to locally do the processing and have intelligence acting at the edge of the network. And this is something you can also play with and build apps upon in the DevNet zone.
And the interesting thing about IOX and data in motion is actually those product teams, they actually accelerated their roadmap to get their APIs ready for you guys to use here. And so this is actually, you guys can write the very first apps using it, and there people are really dedicated to help you guys out, and a lot of excitement there. Great. Do we have more questions from the audience? So the question was, what's being done to deal with a malicious app?
I think that might be for me. So lots and lots and lots. It's so first of all, the SourceFire acquisition that I think I mentioned. So SourceFire has some technology called advanced malware protection. So there's a bunch there. There's behavior execution that monitoring that can be deployed on the endpoint, so on mobile devices as well as on desktops and servers and the like. So we take that kind of behavior description and feed that to a cloud-based analytics engine, very similar to what we were just talking about, to detect malware. And based on that analytics, then push controls back down. So we have this whole, there's announcements, in fact, going on this week around AMP everywhere. You'll see advanced malware protection everywhere, where that notion gets embedded across the whole fabric, across the security devices, across routers and switches and firewalls and the like, to be able to build that up. That's a major component. There's also several other things, integration into ICE that we mentioned, because tying in malware to where it came from, knowing it came from you or your device, then allows the administrator to go and shut that off as a case in point. So lots of integration and tie-ins across the product. So once you find malware, you can actually shut it down and prevent it from propagating.
It's kind of interesting that we're seeing, big data people have talked about a lot, where it's applied most widely is actually in the social media space, where we're trying to find somebody who's just ready to make a purchasing decision and show them an ad. That's, again, behavior. When we can look at these malicious apps by looking at their behavior, we can apply a lot of the same tools for streaming analytics, Storm, and other things to detect that kind of thing. Now, instead of showing them ad, we want to isolate them or shut them off. You may need to approach it at a much lower level.
So repeating your question, so the point is that you may not necessarily be able to go to the cloud. You may need to do it locally, and that's certainly the case. The trade-off, there's a couple trade-offs. The advantage of going to the cloud is in when you look at the whole space of malicious code, oftentimes this economy of scale, if you see one organization gets attacked, then you can take advantage of that effect to protect all the rest of the organization. So that's why it's very appealing to do it in the cloud. That's why you have lots of big service providers that share all those intelligence feeds. We do that as well, right? Because then we can leverage the entire customer base, massive numbers of customers. But to your point, sometimes you can't do it. Sometimes you're isolated. And you can certainly do it in a smaller scope within an organization to be able to share that same model.
You might be running your own cloud for that.
That's exactly right.
So have an on-premise cloud that you can do that for yourself.
You have a private cloud implementation.
Hey, Brett, so I'd like to take this out of the cloud and actually talk about another part of our portfolio, which came in with NDS, which actually is to provide tamper resistance and anti-malware. And what NDS, through that acquisition, was building was ASICs. And what they did and what we've launched over the last 12 months actually are 11 different ASICs from this group that are integrated into, at this point, satellite TV cards that you put into your set-top box to guarantee that you are who you are, the box hasn't been tampered, and somebody's not stealing TV. So we realized that these incredibly small ASICs actually can be used in Internet of Things sensors, in manufacturing, or in electrical grids as well, to provide that exact same anti-tamper, anti-malware, not only on the card that we produce with the supplier, but also checking the entire device which is embedded within. And so we're looking at trying to expand the use of that anti-malware, anti-tamper, anti-security, et cetera, or counterfeit directly into a much, much wider portfolio.
And I'll just say that's hugely important when we talk about SDN, because when the network infrastructure itself is a massive distributed system, you have to worry about it, the attackers going after SDN and coming underneath it, right? Because then you can own the entire network. So hugely important to have a very, very strong root of trust to prevent all these different devices we talked about from being tampered with, to make sure you have the right software that's been digitally signed and you have the right boot sequence to make sure it hasn't been modified.
Yeah, because we know the Internet of Things, the lowest cost device out there, the easiest to implement sensor, is probably one that's the easiest to attack as well. And it's a huge management problem on networks today, whether it's manufacturing or any of the critical infrastructure of any country, to make sure those haven't been attacked. See Stuxnet as an example.
Yeah, we have, to that point, we actually have a bigger IoT security challenge that's going on, to encourage folks to suggest open source approaches to deal with some of these problems. So everybody's encouraged to submit to that. Yeah, so just since John prompted me here, thank you, John. So on the there you go. So the security grant, so it's exactly around this theme, right? The broader notion of IoT, the scale that Dave talked about, the potential vulnerabilities that exist in these systems means that there's lots of opportunity to innovate around security. Frankly, security on the IoT space is very, very immature today. It's got a ways to go, right? And so you think about some of the use cases, IoT in the home, right? IoT in terms of different kinds of industrial control systems in
automobiles,
And all of them have been hacked. I mean, there are examples that are out there.
Unfortunately, there's a lot of opportunities on both sides of the line.
Exactly.
But if you wanted a big hint of what apps and what platforms to start writing to for the next phase of your career, I think you've just been handed a big hint on that one. Building applications that can understand the devices, the state of the network, detect anomalous behavior. This is what we're trying to do through self-learning networks and build very advanced algorithms using neural net algorithms on top of the controller and embedded within iOS to detect anomalous behavior on our IoT gateways to make sure and see if we can predict and detect that a sensor has been compromised. If the sensor's already been deployed, and again, we can't get an anti-counterfeit, anti-malware, et cetera, type chip embedded in it, the only way to do this is in the network and detect that anomalous traffic or that anomalous behavior.
Maybe I'll actually mention also a couple more words about the grand challenges. So Cisco's announced two grand challenges, one in IoT security and one in IoT innovation. And for IoT security, what happens is Cisco's trying to identify the areas where applying our collective intelligence could be very valuable for solving those problems. Cisco will also help you in terms of figuring out more information in this area. There's $250,000 in prize money to the people who help solve these problems. And whoever solves these problems, they still own all the IP for what they have done. So they can take it and go from there. So what Cisco's really...
That grand challenge is what going on for another, I think it's another month or so. Is that right, into June?
I think so.
Like that. So, yeah, it's, again, operators are standing by right now in terms of submitting ideas around that.
If you come up with a great idea, you can help change the world, and you can also can use it going forward if you want, because you will still own the IP for the idea you develop.
So we've been talking about some different Cisco platforms that our DevNet coders can actually be using. Obviously, we're part of a bigger ecosystem. So what other kinds of like open standards or industry consortiums or just what other kind of third party areas are really important to building in that DevNet ecosystem?
Well, I actually think that we should take a look at what's happening with the standards process itself. Standards, I think, right now actually are lagging the implementations, and therefore being involved with a lot of the different open source projects that are out there, we are seeing that's the fastest moving edge of this. So first, I think you're going to see a lot of these things arise in open source, and we shouldn't be afraid of open source. As a matter of fact, many of the proponents of open source feel that that's more secure because you have more eyes looking at that code. And then you can build business models around that. And then following that, we are still taking a dual path. Some of the things that we're driving, such as OpFlex, right through the standards bodies at the same time as we're developing things such as Open Daylight in the open source community. So it's this multi-pronged approach, but we're not going to wait for the standard to be fully defined or whatever before we start writing the code. And this is why I think working code beats everything in the market.
So Lou, you didn't say OpenStack, so I'll say it for you. OpenStack is one thing to pay attention to. The summit was last week. Open Daylight, all the protocols that I've mentioned, including OpFlex, are all going to be open sourced, so that way you can code to them and use them. But also in the IoT space, the open industrial consortium as well is key. And that's pulled together by a number of large manufacturers and vendors of devices themselves. Ourselves, GE, et cetera, are all coming together for an open industrial consortium. That's another key place. Open NFV is another one, another group to work with. So the rise of these platforms, of the controllers, the open sourcing of the protocols, the community is catalyzed. We're ready to go. And it's gone extremely rapidly in the last 2 years to build out these platforms for a developer community around networking.
So can you guys talk about how we have, open source efforts and we have Cisco products? You know, how does all that work together or not work together?
So we made a conscious decision in the portfolio to not only embed some of these open source technologies. Again, OpenStack is one, Open Daylight's another, as well as all of these open source protocols. This is the foundation of our portfolio. We do want the entire community to build on top of this foundation of open source. But we also know that 1-800-CISCO is kind of required for industrial strength or enterprise grade products. And so we continue to build and extend and harden inside our portfolio the use of these open source technologies. We've used Linux for a very long time, as an example. We have OpenStack that Lou's built into our products. Again, Open Daylight as just some key ones. But actually, the list is even longer. We're still contributing to OpenWRT to be able to work on the Linksys devices and bring, whether it's IPv6 or other aspects of home networking. But we're contributing into open source and we're embedding it in our portfolio, but we are building commercial products based on open source.
And one thing I'll add to this, this isn't really that different from what Cisco has always done. We've always participated in standards bodies, and we have innovations. Maybe we haven't contributed in the sense of code, but the ideas have always been part of what has made Cisco, is that openness, the ability to have interoperability to expose all of that. And so this is more of the same. It's much, much deeper now. It certainly is. It's new. It's open source. But philosophically, not that different.
And in fact, by yourselves participating, you get to determine the future of that. I mean, that's what we're seeing in many of these communities. The interested parties are all having their engineers and developers work actively in those communities, so they get to have influence over where it's going to go. And Cisco is doing the same.
And Bret, of course, you do have the largest community out there, which we're only trying to continue to give it gas and accelerate the community around Snort, which is clearly one of the most widely deployed security appliances out there.
That's right. I mean, several of our products are built on Snort, open source, as you said. And the trick there is, if you have something that's open source like that, what's exactly the commercial product? Well, it's about managing, dealing with scale, dealing with the complexity, really taking open source and making it a viable commercial product is a huge amount. So it actually works really well. The other advantage to building on open source is it allows third parties to extend that product, to customize it for a particular area. Like let's say you're working in industrial control systems or in SCADA systems where you have specific narrow security requirements. Something like using open source and Snort allows you to customize it in ways that it's very difficult for any vendor to do out of the box. So it's a really nice balance between starting with open source and then having good, strong commercial products based on it.
Do we have more questions from the audience? Don't be shy. Let me just, we had cut short before. Do you guys have more examples of any third-party integrations, or partner integrations with our various products and platforms that you'd like to talk about?
Well, we have a ton downstairs on APIC EM. So we've got friends who are doing work on IWAN and connecting self-served VPNs. And so APIC EM is a huge one. We know we've got a lot of folks, partners working on the security piece for eventing, alarming, and detecting that anomalous behavior. We have And we have had a number of partners build on top of Open Daylight. And we made acquisitions over the last couple of years where we've taken, for example, Keradin, and now turned this into a real-time WAN orchestration piece by building it on top of a controller. So we're using these platforms to also seed our investments in startups and small companies. We're building key applications on top with very, very important user behavior and operator behavior on top of these platforms. So it's really catalyzing our investments as well.
So I have to confess that I haven't been down to the world of solutions, but I believe it's probably a SAP HANA application being deployed using APIC DC, as well as integration with Embrain, just because I've seen them at other events like this.
Yeah. We also have Citrix here, and there's actually been some very interesting integrations along with Citrix. So we actually showed Citrix with APIC EM using like a Citrix VDI solution. Right, and for VDI, that's a case where kind of the user experience of people using the virtual desktops really depend on how well that application is being streamed across the network. So we can actually set policies, interact with NetScaler, use APIC EM to adjust the policies to the network devices. And it's been, you know, fantastic integration there.
So
as
Susie,
well.
In addition, of course, a number of other partners out there, whether it's F5, but what Lou was mentioning was his cloud DVR. We built that onto a VCE FlexPod. And so taking a look and understanding how we can create manufactured orchestrated solutions based on OpenStack is fantastic. And so most of the world's solutions are partners building on top of these platforms downstairs.
Absolutely.
And we've also had a great partnership with Landcope, for example, to leverage NetFlow data. Landcope does the analytics on top of that. That, to the point, has worked really, really well to be able to, you know, pull lots of different NetFlow feeds from the whole fabric. There's several other partnerships, but I don't think they've been announced yet, but it's in a couple days, so I'm in danger of pre-announcing there, so I'll stop. But there's actually several more this week that we're going to be talking about on that front.
When is Chris's keynote, when he's announcing those?
That is Wednesday.
Okay, so Wednesday is Chris Young's security keynote.
That's right.
Great. And for some more information about how SourceFire had kind of come to be, Marty Roche is the founder of SourceFire. We'll actually have an exec spotlight interview with him. I think it's on Wednesday. The date's on your schedule, so you can take a look there. And it's very interesting, his story about he kind of grew this little open source project in his backyard
that's
or upstairs
great,
or basement
that's a great
in
story.
The garage.
Really, started from the garage and bought for $2.7 billion, so not a bad success story.
That could
there.
Be you.
He'll be here with his personal bodyguards.
all driven by open source, right?
All driven by open source.
Focus, yeah.
Great. Have you seen an actual push from the traditional hardware partners to get involved in any of this? Because, I mean, Cisco's been traditionally more hardware, so I don't know if you've seen a worldwide push from them, a traditional partner, to get into the software part.
So we certainly see it with our partners with EMC for certain as we build out VCE and continue to push that forward. So as we know, the automation of networking, we talked a lot about this morning, the automation of compute, we still have extremely strong partnerships with VMware. We've recently announced partnerships with Microsoft, Citrix, Red Hat, IBM.
Canonical.
Canonical, exactly. And so these pieces become key. On the hardware side, folks are working with us and our suppliers, and whether they're our chip manufacturers or other hardware controller manufacturers, are working with us such that the drivers, SDKs, and what's programmable in those chips or in those devices are part of the ecosystem. Or otherwise, they can't be partners with us anymore. We have fully gone to the point where everything has to be programmable. And so where I was going with EMC, as you know, the virtualization of storage and making sure that what is being able to be built can be controlled in new virtual storage or hierarchical storage mechanisms from SSD all the way down to cold storage is key for us and key for our partnerships as we're driving them in that direction, and they're help pulling us as well.
NAP is another one where we're partnering very closely on the storage side with the vBlock, as well as integration with a data center ACI approach.
And one of the attributes I think you're seeing as we get involved in these open source communities, we engage that entire community, that entire ecosystem around these other products. So that's why with NetApp and with F5, we have these relationships now through OpenStack and these other communities for us to be able to work with them.
And rinse and repeat through GPUs in the UCS portfolio with our relationship with NVIDIA, as that's you know, who we partner with for GPUs, that they clearly have a platform and entire tool chain enabling application developers to code directly to the GPU, as well as migrate it between, you know, let's say the Intel-based CPUs we have on the UCS blades and the GPU.
So what's really interesting is, and thank you for raising the question, is as we talk about this area of network function virtualization, you know, NFV or software-defined networking, and kind of the shift to software, there's still hardware underneath there. And there's actually many areas where you get serious performance benefits, you know, through power, performance, and so on, where actually having, you know, hardware implementations still makes a lot of sense and makes a big difference. So sometimes when we talk about NFV and SDN, what we want to be able to do is kind of virtualize resources. Sometimes software resources can be placed in different locations and spread, and that kind of virtualization is fantastic. But if you have hardware boxes that have improved performance, that can do really well, that are located on, you know, specific tasks, then for God's sake, we need to use those, right? So we have APIs into those that actually let the systems know where those are and then kind of smartly, you know, use those benefits, and we can optimize for power. We actually have some things that show for a number of networking functions, you know, kind of, you know, as you get to really high performance areas, it's actually, in, once you take power into consideration, the amount of kind of compute and power that you need to do is actually three orders of magnitude difference in hardware versus software. So so there's a lot of places where software, of course, helps a lot, but there's areas where it certainly makes sense to include the hardware, and that has to become part of this software fabric.
So we saw this, and this is one of the reasons why we targeted Whiptail as an acquisition, because they had the ability to have a programmable controller and the hardware controller over their SSD flash implementation. And we were clearly going for the highest possible IOPS with Whiptail. But the ability to tie it into the network, the ability to actually control how and where that data is being placed, as well as control the SSDs for power as well, became a key piece on why we selected Whiptail.
Tom? And the ACI policy model is completely agnostic about whether the underlying compute platforms are physical servers or they're virtualized, which hypervisor it is. The policies are the same and works exactly the same across all of those. So what we see happening in the industry, while yes, more and more workloads are being virtualized, and probably 65-70% of the workloads are virtualized, that's done on 20% of the servers, because each one of those servers is virtualized may carry 10, 15, 20 workloads. And so there are still quite a lot, as much as 80% of those servers out there that are not virtualized. And so that's a significant part of the infrastructure. And we see applications, well, yes, many of them are going toward virtualization. Some of them are actually pulling back. You don't see Hadoop, as an example, is typically run on bare metal. A lot of your databases are running on bare metal because they do their own embedded virtualization. So this, the whole equation between what's hardware, what software is very, very fluid. Having a policy model that is agnostic to that can be extremely powerful. So you don't have to deal with the nuances. You don't have to change how you write your applications because, oh, this component happens to be virtual or doesn't happen to be virtual.
And it allows us to tie together. So we take the data model and the information model that Tom mentioned. You take a look at UCS Director, which did that for compute. When we picked up Cloudbio, you now have basically an enterprise private cloud in a box, being able to orchestrate compute, storage, and virtual overlays of those workloads directly. And we have, and because UCS Director is in fact a software platform that can be programmed to, that integration of those partners and now part of the Cisco family was much, much easier and faster to accomplish.
Great. So let's see. Any last question from the audience?
Yep.
Yep.
How about, I mean, Cisco and the channel partners you have, the CCNPs, the CCIEs, how are you trying to migrate that to, you know, get involved with people to the software part also?
Absolutely. So there's actually a number of areas. So first of all, in our CCIE program, in our training program, we've actually added specializations for network programmability. And so we actually have new training material to actually help, you know, again, our folks who are, you know, you guys can run mission critical infrastructures, right? They can run that require business apps or down for a minute, huge impacts on business. But we actually want to help these folks move into software. So we actually have, you know, again, network programmability training classes. We're actually going to be offering certification for those. In addition, That's what DevNet is all about, okay? So DevNet has two audiences. So one is those crackerjack programmers who, you know all about software, but maybe don't know about Cisco technology or don't know how to run a mission-critical infrastructure. The other audience is, you know, our CCIEs, our folks who really know how to run stuff, but are a little rusty on their coding, right? Haven't done it, hasn't been part of their day job. So that's where we have, again, the Coding 101 class here to help people out. The mini labs in this middle area are actually places you can actually just walk and start clicking and click APIs into running versions of APIC EM, into running versions of CMX, you know, using Viral. So we actually have all these labs set up here so people can kind of get their feet wet and just be programming again, you know, and get their feeling for that.
And where this is headed is us providing a certification for application developers that they have coded to the platform and APIs properly. And so as we begin to make this, as we're making this transition, we realize that certification for an IT professional's application or a partner's application is required for us to be able to, you know, all work together and make sure that an application which was written, you know, too quickly or whatever the case, doesn't take down the network.
So DevNet is really about bringing our community along into the software world. So we very much welcome, you know, everybody who wants to learn about software. No experience necessary there. Okay, so one final question for the panel, which is that, okay, so here we have our DevNet community folks over here. What's your kind of final message? What would you like to see from them in the hackathon or ongoing afterwards, or what call to action do you have for our DevNet members? Go ahead, Bret.
Yeah, I think we already said it, actually, which is starting to check out this this IoT security challenge. I think there's some really interesting opportunities there. It's a, you know, if you got some ideas, it's all about building open source around innovation for security and IoT. So check it out. I think you'll find that definitely worth your time. Thanks.
As you've heard from all of us up here, the developer network is very important for our future with Internet of Everything and many other areas. I'm very eager to see some of the exciting things you're going to build over the next few days in the DevNet. So please surprise us. I'm sure there's a lot of creativity here. Please surprise us on the applications and things you can build.
Yeah, I would just like to say, just get involved. Many of you maybe haven't written code before, but that's why we do have Coding 101 going on. We want to bring the entire community into this new world and ask for help. Actually, you'll find developers are some of the friendliest people around in terms of wanting to show you how they've done something. So share your examples and just join the community.
Yeah, just echoing that participation, call for participation, and I encourage you all to take a look at what we're doing with this application-centric view and how it's a new way to think about managing your network and expressing what you want that network to do and what it can do for you.
And I'd say tune in and turn on. It's the time to get involved, both here at DevNet as well as in open source, and win $5,000. So good luck to all of you in the hackathon.
It's the prize for the hackathon. So so let me just close by just kind of, again, explaining DevNet again. So first of all, the DevNet portal is at developer.cisco.com. There's some community forums there, so you can go to the website, join DevNet, just ask questions in the community. We really want to start that conversation, so please join in there. Here in the DevNet zone, we have, you know, theater presentations going on here throughout. They'll start to get more detailed or have more, you know, higher level overviews. We actually have this area staffed, so the people who actually write these platforms, you know, as Lou said, you know, our developers, they're friendly. You know, they do want to work. They might be introverted, so you might have to ask them the first question, but once you open that door, they're going to tell you everything because they'll be so excited about it. So please do interact. For example, here's Adam. So APIC EM, any question about APIC EM, talk to Adam, wave your hand so that they get there. Okay, friendly guy. the idea behind the zone is that we actually have tickets that we'll give out, so as you actually do different things, actually right now, come over here to Ed, you're gonna get a ticket, you collect enough tickets, then you can go to the far booth and get prizes. So just because you sat here, you're actually gonna get a ticket here. Same thing, you do a mini lab, you get a ticket. You actually will get these bracelets to show, hey, I learned about Viral, you know, or I learned about you know, Mobile Advisor. So as you go through, wear them around, you can actually get a t-shirt, you know, at the, and if you wear your t-shirt the next day and you come back, then you actually get another ticket for wearing your t-shirt. So tell other people about DevNet. So there's my little sales job.
Thanks, Susie. Good job.
So thank you to all of our CTOs. I hope that you all found this useful. And, you know, again, it's really great to get all of your time here. Kind of shows the importance and how the CTO feels about the DevNet community here as well. Great.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.